So, hello everyone. So today my topic is Payment of Gratuity Act 1972 from Industrial Law. So Payment of Gratuity Act 1972 is going to guide you whenever the time will come to obtain the or to get or to receive the gratuity amount from your company. Okay. And also this act is going to guide those corporates or those companies how they're going to pay the gratuity amount to their employees. Okay, what are the rules, what are the provisions, what are the points needs to be remembered whenever you are going to deal with this gratuity as per Payment of Gratuity Act 1972. Now the basic some points we should remember, that is, when this act came into effect from 16th September 1972. So this Gratuity Act came into effect means enforcement date, that means this act passed in the parliament on 16th September 1972. So this is the enforcement date of this act, that is Payment of Gratuity Act. Next is the definition or the meaning, that when a person or an employee is entitled or is having right to receive the gratuity. So as per this act, an employee is entitled to gratuity if he has worked for 5 continuous years of service in an establishment on which Gratuity Act is applicable. Gratuity will be paid by the employer to such employee at the time of retirement, resignation, death or disablement. So from this second point, we can conclude. First, there are two parts. Part A, and you can say Part B. Under Part A, it was telling ki the employees are entitled to receive the gratuity whenever they will work for 5 continuous year of service. So a person, if until and unless completes 5 years of service continuously, he is not entitled to receive the gratuity. So very important, first part is telling any employees or person who want to claim gratuity amount, they should complete 5 continuous year of service. Now this continuous year I will explain in the next slide, just mark it. And part B is when this person, if they completes the continuous 5 years of service, so they are entitled to receive the gratuity. But when? So usually when they can get or they can claim the gratuity? Gratuity usually paid by the employer to the employees at the time of retirement, resignation, death or disablement. Got it? So this is gratuity amount you can claim if first part A satisfy, that is if you have to work continuously 5 years in that organization or in an organization, then you can claim gratuity. But when the employers are having when the employers will pay the gratuity amount to you at your retirement, that is after your retirement, also or else whenever you are going to resign from that company, or else after your death to your nominee, or whenever you will become disabled, your nominee or your family member can claim gratuity and can get. Okay. Next is, this act is applicable to the employees. Okay. But employees of which type of organization? So this act is applicable to the employees who are engaged in factories, mines, oil field, plantation, ports, railway companies, shops or other establishment. So if any person is employed or working in factory, mines, oil field, plantation, port, railway company, shops or other establishment, this act is applicable on them. That is Payment of Gratuity Act 1972. So in the last slide, I already explained that this continuous year, I already said that when a person is entitled to receive gratuity, when he will complete the 5 continuous year. Now this continuous year is having some meaning. Okay, just draw a chart with me. What does this continuous year means as per Payment of Gratuity Act 1972? Payment of continuous year will be of two types. One is for the people or for the employees who work above the ground, and continuous years for the people who are working under the ground. That means you can say, example, mine, coal. Normally they works under the ground, which is much more hazardous than the people who are working above the ground. So above the ground means the building is situated above the ground, like any office and all. We are going and we are working there, factory which is there in above the ground, all these things. But under the ground means that mine factory, coal factory, these are all usually situated under the ground. So these are much more dangerous. To work here is much more challenging than to work above the ground. So now continuous year meaning is there as per this act from both the perspective. So let us start with the above the ground. Like the employees who are working above the ground, for them continuous year means, if you are if you say like 1 year's point of view, from 1 year's point of view, minimum 240 days the employee should work. Then we can say like this continuous year satisfied and he is entitled to receive the gratuity. So minimum, whoever is working above the ground and from 1 year's perspective, okay, minimum 240 days he should work. Okay, if he works minimum 240 days, then we can say yes, he satisfied the definition of continuous year and that person is entitled to receive the gratuity. Next is 6 months point of view. Minimum 120 days. Okay. And if he has not completed 1 year and we are counting from 6 months point of view, then the employee should satisfy or should work minimum 120 days. Then we can say yes, he is satisfied the condition of continuous year and he is entitled to receive the gratuity. So from 1 year's point of view 240 and from 6 months point of view minimum 120, and this is all about above the ground. Now come to under the ground portion. Those who are working under the ground, like mine or coal factory, like that. Here also, from 1 year's point of view, minimum 190 days they should work, then only they will be entitled to receive the gratuity. And from 6 months point of view, minimum 95 days. Okay, so 1 year, because their number of days are less, because though their work is much more challenging than this above the ground. So from the 1 year's perspective, minimum 190 days they should work, and from 6 months point of view, minimum 195 days they should work. Then we can say like these employees are entitled to receive the gratuity amount as per Payment of Gratuity Act 1972. Next is, what do you mean by appropriate government? Appropriate government, we actually, let me explain you in the name first. What do you mean by the appropriate government? That means the government which is appropriate for the situation. Okay, so whenever we don't know who is going to deal with any specific thing, so there are actually two government, we all know. One is CG, central government, one is SG, state government. So whenever we don't know a specific thing who will deal, so we use this term appropriate government. That is, whoever government is appropriate to deal this situation, that government will deal it. So we, in that situation, in that case, we actually use the term appropriate government. So you can say appropriate government means any authority which is under the control of central government, or appropriate government means any factory is under the control of central government. Okay, and port, mine, oil field, railway company, if it is controlled by central government, then also we can call it like it is an appropriate government. Okay, and in any other cases, if it is controlled by state government, that will be also coming under the appropriate government. So normally appropriate government are of two types, CG and SG. On the other hand, we can say like any authority, if it is coming under the control of central government, then that is also a type of appropriate government. Any factory under the control of central government, that is also coming under the appropriate government. Or any port, mine, oil field, railway company which is controlled by central government, that is also coming under appropriate government. Or in any other authority controlled by the state government is appropriate government. So as per Payment of Gratuity Act 1972, appropriate government means this 4 points. Now, what do you mean by an employee as per Payment of Gratuity Act 1972? First is, apprentice cannot be treated as an employee. What do you mean by apprentice? Apprentice means trainees. So trainees of an organization, or trainee or trainees of an organization, cannot be treated as an employee. Got it? Then who is employee? Employee means any person who employed for wages. That means any person who are working in exchange of money, and that is also in exchange of wages. Wages means basic salary plus DA. Okay. And whom we can call employee as per Payment of Gratuity Act? Those, any person who is in connection with the work of factory, mine, oil field, plantation, port, railway company, shop or other establishment. So any person, if they are connected, already we have read, like this act will deal with the person who is directly connected with these type of establishment. So any person who is in connection with the work of these factory, mine, oil field, plantation, port, railway company, shop, other establishment, those person, if they are working in for wages, these person we can call it as an employee as per Payment of Gratuity Act 1972. Next is, what do you mean by an employer? So first of all, I would like to say to those people who have done the Factories Act and other industrial chapters, industrial law chapters, I would like to say, or Wages Act, Payment of Wages Act, for them, the definition of employer is same as others. Okay, if you read one definition, you can write all the chapter under industrial law, same meaning, okay, of employer. Still, what do you mean by employer as per this act, that is Payment of Gratuity Act 1972? First is known to you, like the person. The must be employed is also a person who must be in connection with the work of factory, mines, oil field, plantation, port, railway company, shop or other establishment. Okay. They are known as employer. Next is, any authority or an authority which is under the control of central or state government. We already said, like, any authority under the control of state or central government is also called an appropriate government. And if this authority is this authority or any person who is appointed by the appropriate government for the supervision or control of the employees, in that case, the person who got appointed, that person will be the employer. Okay, so in that case, what happened? Appropriate government means CG or SG. Okay, if they are appointing any person or an authority to act as an employer or to supervise or to control the employees, okay, to control the employees, then these person or authority will be treated as an employer. Next, same like any establishment which is under the control of local authority, then this local authority is going to appoint a person who is going to supervise or control the employees. This person will be known as an employer. Or in any other case, the person who is having ultimate control over the affairs of the establishment, that person means occupier, or who is having ultimate control over the affairs of the establishment or organization, that person will be known as an employer. Next is, what do you mean by family? Okay, so all you I hope you have read the definition of family in tax. So almost same here also, as per Payment of Gratuity Act 1972, family means for male employees, he himself, his wife, okay, his children, his whether married or unmarried, okay, his dependent parents, that is his male employees, father, mother, parents, dependent parents of his wife, or if he is having any, means the widow and the children of his predeceased son. What do you mean by predeceased son? Predeceased means if he was having a son and now he is dead. So if he, that his dead son's wife or his children, we called it predeceased son. So that they are also coming under this family for male members. And similarly for female members also, herself, her husband, her children, whether married or unmarried, his dependent parents, his dependent parents of her husbands, and same like the widow and children of her predeceased son. So if before her death, if any her son, predeceased son was there, so if if her son was not no more, like was dead, and his dead son's widow, wife or children was there, is there, then they will come under the family of female member also, female employee also. So these people are coming under the family. And in case, the means in case like gratuity, we said like their gratuity is going to be paid by the employer at the time of retirement, at the time of resignation, death and disablement. So at the time of death and disablement, these family members are entitled to claim the gratuity amount on behalf of the actual employee. Next is, what do you mean by superannuation? Superannuation means, superannuation is money which people pay regularly into a specific fund so that when they retire from their job, they will receive money regularly as a pension. It is an organizational pension program created by a company for the benefit of its employees. So you know, the government employee is itself having that pension fund. That is, after their retirement, they usually get the pension, and this pension amount is fully contributed by the government. Got it? But think about the non-government companies. Okay, so for them, pension means like they are deducting some amount from the employee's salary and keeping in a separate fund. And so that after retirement, these employees will enjoy or will get the pension amount from that fund. So that is actually superannuation. So these non-government companies are having no pension concept. Okay, they don't have this pension concept like government. So what they are having this superannuation. So they usually, what they do, they prepare a fund. They will give the name of this fund is pension fund. And they simply deduct some money, okay, from the salary of the employees, and will transfer this fund in this fund. And the employees, whenever after retirement, they are going to get a pension amount, okay, one amount regularly into means they are going to get receive that money regularly as a pension from this fund, which they have saved their whole life during their tenure of their service or during their time of service. They have saved this money in that fund in the form of this. This is known as superannuation. So continuous service already we have discussed. So continuous service means it's an uninterrupted service. Continuously you have to work, but that doesn't means that continuously means you cannot take sick leave or any type of leave, or if you meet an accident you cannot take leave. That is not there. Uninterrupted service means you have not taken a long term leave. Okay, not long term gap should not be there. That means uninterrupted service. And such uninterrupted service on account of like which may be interrupted, we can, it excludes this factor: sickness, accident, leave, absence from duty, layoff, strike off or lockout. Okay, so uninterrupted service means we said 5 years continuous service, and continuous service means it is uninterrupted. Uninterrupted means it should not, in middle should not, there should not be a long gap. Got it? But uninterrupted service may include sickness, accident, leave, absence or duty, layoff, strike, lockout, anything. This is okay. Okay, so if you take a leave or sick leave, that doesn't mean you are interrupting your service. Okay, so this service may be interrupted by all these things. And in other way, continuous service means, just refer my second third slide of this PPT, whatever, wherever I explained through a chart, go through that. So continuous service, meaning of continuous service, you can refer that diagram. Next is exceptions. We all know, like, until and unless the employee satisfy this 5 continuous year, they are not entitled to receive the gratuity. But 2 exceptions are there. If the employees don't even work, they don't satisfy also that 5 continuous year, then also they can claim the gratuity. First exception is there for seasonal workers. Who are seasonal workers? They work in the seasonal factory to manufacture, or you can say to produce some seasonal goods or seasonal product, like example cotton, jute, coffee, rubber, sugar, tea, etc. So these are the products or goods which can be produced in season only. Not, they cannot do it in whole year, or it is not a long term thing. So these are all seasonal product, and when that season will come, at a specific season or specific time, they are going to produce it, these things. Got it? So these workers, we called it seasonal workers. So for them, the rules are something different than the actual one. For them, if they don't satisfy this 5 continuous year also, then also they can claim gratuity. But one condition is there, they should work at least 75% of total days. Now, who is going to decide these total days? This will be decided by their organization or industry or else their factory. So as per their industry, some dates will be specified as a total days of their. Means that total days, like 365 days is there. Now in your organization, total days you have to work like 300 days. Now 300 days will be fixed by that industry or organization for you people. And for that, these seasonal workers should work at least 75% of that total days. Then we can say, yes, he is satisfying the condition. So he can claim the gratuity amount. So no need to satisfy this 5 continuous year of service. So this is first exception of this act. And second is, in case of death and disablement, gratuity has to be paid even if the above conditions are not satisfied. Got it? So in case suddenly your employees met an accident, and in case of his death, or he became disabled, either permanent disabled or temporary disablement, So in such cases, as per Act, gratuity has to be paid by the employer if 5 years, 5 continuous years of service also does not satisfy it. Okay, so as per Act, in case of death and disablement, the employers are liable and obliged, or it's their obligation to pay the gratuity amount to them. What is in that time, they cannot check the condition, whether this condition satisfied or not, doesn't matter. When is gratuity payable? That means when gratuity is payable by the employer to employee. Obviously, on his superannuation. Superannuation is all means usually get after retirement only. Those who don't have that pension concept, they usually have a superannuation fund, and from there they used to get some regular amount in the form of pension. Okay. Next is after retirement also. You are supposed to claim the gratuity amount. If you resign from the organization, then you can claim the gratuity amount, and gratuity amount is payable. Or on the death, on his death or disablement due to accident or disease, then also the person or employee is entitled to receive the gratuity amount from the employer. Next is the calculation of the amount of gratuity payable. Got it. So as per this Act, that is Payment of Gratuity Act 1972, the maximum amount of gratuity allowed under this Act is 10 lakh. Okay. So as per this Act, it is allotted that maximum amount of gratuity you can pay, that is 10 lakh. Next is, what will be the calculation? Formula is there. Last drawn wage multiply by 15 by 26. So 15 means you have to calculate, if you take 1 month, that is 30 days, you have to calculate on half month basis. Got it? That is 15 days. You have to calculate on the basis of 15 days wages of last drawn salary, and in excess of 6 months, means you can say on a part in excess of 6 months. That means those who you are doing half, so you have to take the half month salary for, that is for 15 days, and divided by 26. 26 is the weeks, that is 6 months. If you calculate in 6 months, total week will come 26 weeks. Okay, into completed year of service. So last drawn wages of 15 days divided by 6 months week, you have to divide it by, I mean 6 months, in 6 months we were going to calculate on the basis of weeks, into how many years you have completed your service. So on the basis of that, you have to calculate the gratuity amount. So for every completed year of service or a part in excess of 6 months, at the rate of 15 days wages last drawn. Got it? So this will be the formula for calculation of gratuity amount. Nomination means every employee, actually after completion of 1 year of service, shall make a nomination in Form F. So the thing is, being an employee, you cannot claim your gratuity amount until and unless you finish or you complete your 5 continuous years. But you have to submit your detail just after completion of 1 year of service. Got it? So whenever you are entering into an organization or you have appointed, so after completion of 1 year of your service, you have to fill a form, you have to submit a nomination form F in with your organization. In that nomination form, you have to write one or name of or details, name and details of one or more member of your family. So you all know, like gratuity also received after death, as well as whenever any employees will become disabled, after disablement also they will get the gratuity. So if you become disabled, or if in case after your death, who is going to accept, or who is going to take that, who is going to claim that gratuity amount on behalf of you? So beforehand, you have to nominate someone. Okay, you have to give a nominee names. Okay, it may be anyone, one or two names you can suggest and that you have to submit. There is a nomination form. You have to fill that form and you have to submit in your organization by suggesting two or three names from your family. After your disablement or your death, these people, your nominee, can claim the gratuity from your organization. What are the procedures for determination of the amount of gratuity? Okay, so procedure means when an employee will come to know ki now I am eligible to claim or get the gratuity amount, or vice versa. That implies it's a responsibility of the employer to inform the employees about this gratuity amount, now the gratuity amounts payable, etc. So as soon as the gratuity becomes payable, like obviously employer will shall have the one calculation of their own, like after retirement they should pay the gratuity, these are the employees, they should receive the gratuity from them, etc., etc. So these calculation usually there always, all means should be there with every organization. So as soon as the gratuity will become payable, the employer shall give a notice to the person to whom the gratuity is payable. So once the employer will come to know, or they will make a list of the people to whom the gratuities are payable or will be payable. So what they will do, the employer is going to give a notice, okay, in form L. Okay, they will give, employer is going to give a notice to those employee only to whom the gratuity is payable, who are eligible to get the gratuity, to them only. Once the gratuity becomes payable from the date, from that date, means once it is becomes applicable or it becomes payable, employer is going to give the notice in form L to the employee. Okay, next is, the employer shall arrange to pay the amount of gratuity within 30 days from the date of becoming payable to the person whom it is payable. So once, from the date when it becomes payable, employer will have to give or shall have to arrange to pay that gratuity amount to the employee within 30 days from the date it becomes payable, or the from the date its act become applicable. Got it? Now, in case of any delay in payment, that means, for example, like last month, it's within, before last month it got applicable, and within 30 days they have not, they failed to pay the gratuity amount. So they delayed na. So in case of delayed in payment, employer have to pay the interest. 10% interest they should pay. Got it? In case they fail to pay the gratuity amount within 30 days from the date the act becomes applicable, okay, the employer have to pay extra 10% interest. But in case the employee, if this is the fault of the employee to receive, means employees are not getting time to come visit to the company, and they have no, means they are delaying to take the amount, in case of employees delay to receive the payment, then no interest will be imposed. Got it? What will be the mode of payment of gratuity? Okay, so while paying the gratuity amount, what will be the mode? It may be in cash, DD, demand draft, or you can give a check also, and any electronic mode, you can transfer also. Some compliance is there. For example, see, as per rule 10, if an employer refuses to accept nomination or refuses to entertain an application for gratuity, or rejects the eligibility of gratuity, or indicates less amount than the eligible amount of gratuity in the notice, or fails to issue notice, the eligible person to receive the gratuity may file an application in form N within 90 days from the date of occurrence of cause to the controlling authority. Controlling authority, there is some rules. See, let me explain. I am going to explain you in the next slide. So let me read first the point. Second point is telling, the controlling authority on receipt of an application shall issue a notice in form O, call upon the applicant as well as the employer to appear before him on a specified date, time and place. And any person, if aggrieved by an order of the controlling authority, he can appeal to the appropriate government within 60 days from the date of receipt of the order. So I'm going to explain this 3 point in the next slide. They are telling, in case you are an employee, okay, in case the employee, for example, is claiming gratuity from an employer, okay, when employee came to know, like now he is eligible to receive the gratuity amount. So employee will file an application before an employer and will claim the gratuity amount. Okay, so employee, you have filed an application and there you have written that you are eligible to receive the gratuity amount and you are claiming your amount from the employer. On receipt of this application, if employer reject your application, and if you are feeling that this rejection means this he has done something wrong to you, he should not reject your application, okay, he has done something wrong to you, then you, there is one authority, controlling authority. Controlling authority is usually there who is working or who got appointed by the appropriate government to take care of all these disputes related matter, whether you are getting the gratuity amount on time or not, whether you are you have received the actual amount or not, whether calculation is okay or not. If you are any disputes related related to this gratuity amount payable or while receiving this amount, if any dispute arises or not, all disputes is going to be solved by this controlling authority. And who is controlling this controlling authority? Appropriate government. Now, whenever you are feeling that your application got rejected by the employer and that it's wrongly and some wrong is happening with you, then what you can do, within 90 days, you can file an application in form N to this authority, that is controlling authority. Okay, so within 90 days you can file an application in form N to this controlling authority. Now think, controlling authority reviewed your factor and given you some suggestion or order and you are not satisfied with the order whatever is given by controlling authority. Okay, so on receipt of your application, controlling this controlling authority is going to review and is going to give you the order and you are not satisfied with this order, so you are aggrieved. If you are still aggrieved, I'm writing here, if you are still aggrieved, what do you mean by this term aggrieved? That means you are not satisfied with the order, whatever you have received from the controlling authority. Then you can file within 60 days to appropriate government with the order, whatever you have received from controlling authority. Got it? So it's a, you can refer like basic thing what happened in normal life, what happened. If we face any problem, where we go? High court. Okay. If High Court is going to give you any order or statement, if you are not satisfied with this order, then we go to Supreme Court. But as per law, you cannot directly go to Supreme Court. This is forbidden. So first you have to go to High Court. If you are not satisfied with the High Court order, then you can go to Supreme Court. Similarly, here also, first you have to go to controlling authority. If you are not satisfied with the order of the controlling authority, then only you can go to the appropriate government. Directly, you cannot go to appropriate government. This is the meaning of the previous slide of those three points. Now, who is this controlling authority? Actually, so appropriate, where the appropriate government is the state government of the act. For example, appropriate government means what? It's a state or central, both, right? But in case if there is a state government, okay, state government of the act, the assistant labor commissioner or the labor cum conciliation officer of the area will be appointed as a controlling authority under the Payment of Gratuity Act. Got it? So whenever the appropriate government is a state government, and in that area you have to appoint any assistant labor commissioner or labor cum conciliation officer from that area as a controlling authority under this act, who is going to deal with the disputes relating to the gratuity, payment of gratuity. What will be their powers? What are the powers of controlling authority? They are going to enforce the attendance of any person on examining him on oath. They are going to check the attendance register. If he feels like any fraud is there, he can examine those person. They are going to discover and production of documents, whether all documents are correct or not, or whether any documents are in place or not. Everything they are going to discover. They are going to receive the evidence on affidavits. If they need any evidence, they are not going to accept the evidence in a plain sheet of paper. They will take or accept this evidence on affidavit. Affidavit is a legal papers, you know, it's a court paper, usually in a stamp paper and all. And obviously issuing commission for the examination of witness. In case if necessary, then they are going to issue commission also and will give the order to examine the witness. If he feels that any fraud is going on, then for investigation purpose, he can issue the commission who are going to examine the witnesses. Next is penalties. Obviously, whatever rules and regulation we have read under this chapter, if you don't follow those rules and regulations while paying the gratuity amount, then obviously you will be punished. So see, for penalties, for the purpose of avoiding any payment to be made or knowingly made any false statement or false representation. Okay, so if you are avoiding to pay the amount, okay, and that is also knowingly, you are just giving a false statement, false representing anyone, then you will be punishable with the imprisonment. Imprisonment means jail, maximum 6 month jail will be there, and your fine may extend 1,000 or both. Okay, if any employer contravenes these rules, okay, in complying with the provisions of whatever rules and regulation we have read till now, if the employer failed to follow the rules, then punishment is there, maximum 1 year jail and payment and fine is 1,000 or both on the best of crime. And finally, if the offense is relates to the non-payment of any gratuity amount, okay, under this act, then also the jail is maximum 3 months and which may extend to 1 year, or fine amount is not mentioned, that will be fixed by the authority on the basis of your crime. Next is the provisions relating to the exemptions given to the employer from the liability in certain cases from the payment of gratuity are as follows. So always it is not like that ki whenever the employees are claiming the gratuity, employees has to pay the gratuity amount. Exemptions are always available. Got it? So employees are claiming gratuity amount, obviously it should be twice checked by the employer whether employee is eligible to get or receive the gratuity amount now or not. Okay, so if employees are claiming gratuity and employers are feeling no, this is wrong, time not came to receive the gratuity by that employee, then employer can bring a charge against this employee, okay, as the actual offender. He can tell like this person is simply were submitted a wrong application and wrongly he is claiming the gratuity amount. Okay, the employer is having right to brought a charge against him as an actual offender. Okay, now the thing is, the case may go to the court if the employer brought a charge against this employee. Now court obviously will give a hearing date, that court is going to listen to both of them. So court is going to give a hearing date where both the employer and employee should appear before the court. In case employer or employee if failed to appear before the court, then what will happen? The case will not close. Court is simply going to adjourn the meeting or adjourn the hearing date, but this has to be done within 3 months. It should not be done more than 3 months. So within 3 months again, they have to appear before the court for such hearing. Got it? So these are the exemptions and liabilities need to be followed by the employer while paying the gratuity. So this is not always important ki employee is claiming the gratuity, means employer has to pay it. Employer has to check thrice whether time came or not for the payment of gratuity. If he feels like no, it is wrongly they are claiming, and still then employer is having right to cross-examine that person and bring a charge as an actual offender. Got it? And in that case also, when the court will give some specific appointment date of hearing, in that case, if the employee or employees fail to appear before the court, then the court is going to adjourn the hearing time to time, but not exceeding 3 months. Within 3 months, they have to appear before the court and have to close the matter. These are the exemptions given to the employer to follow actually from the liability in certain cases from payment of gratuity. Got it? Finally, employer, you know, for every corporate or for every organization, usually we file an annual return. We have to submit the annual return with the ROC. Okay, so here also, what they will do, here also some rules are there for the organization or for the employer as per this Gratuity Act. Okay, so the employer, what they will do, some obligations are there from the employer side. They should display an abstract. Abstract means a summary of this act and rules in form U. Got it? So employer is going to, there will be a notice board obviously. They have to display their rules and regulation, okay, relating to this Gratuity Act in form number U, and you have to paste that. And everyone, whenever this act will become applicable on them, they can follow that display, okay, in their factory or in the notice board, a summary, so that it's some kind of guidance to them and all. So the rules and regulation, they have to write it and they have to paste it on the notice board, and the whatever rules and regulation they will write in the form U. Got it? So this act and rules summary they have to display for the betterment or for the understanding purpose of their employees. So thank you.
Hello students, hope you all are well and safe. So today I want to share something. I hope the page is visible. I'm very happy to share that my first book got published on the topic business law, and I have written this book according to the syllabus of CMA Inter, BCom, MCom and for MBA aspirant. This book contains portion of commercial law, industrial law, company law, and it is completely exam specific. So what are you waiting for? Go and grab it. It is now available in Amazon, Flipkart, Notion Press, Amazon Kindle, Apple Bookstore, Google Play, as well as Kobo. And also requesting you to share with your friends so that they also get chance to have it. So thank you.